Good morning. Welcome to RCCG Tabernacle of Grace service this morning. Thank God that today is a Palm Sunday, and it's good that you are here to worship with us this morning. Thank you for joining in. We are going to start today. Just let us first of all pray and just appreciate God for His mercy, His love. From last week to this week, He has always been a faithful God. Lord, we thank You. We give You praise. We exalt You, for You are a faithful God. Thank You for life. Thank You for mercy that speaks over our life. Thank You for this morning. Thank You that You are here with us. Lord, as we've come to worship You, as we've come to lift Your name high, Lord, we pray that You take all the glory. We pray that You take all the honor. We pray that You take every adoration. Lord, thank You for Your presence with us. Receive all the praise, receive all the worship for prayer. So we are going to start today's service just lifting the name of God high. So we are going to go into our praise and worship this morning. So I want you, wherever you are, just join us this morning and just appreciate God and give God praise. So just join us and worship God. Just wherever you are, just clap your hands and join us. Just rejoice. He's in God's presence. The Lord is good. He has been faithful to us. Just worship Him wherever you are. I'm gonna dance and praise Him. It doesn't matter what comes my way. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. I'm head of His kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. Just love, just worship Him. It is unto God. Just lift Him up. He is worthy of our praise. Just worship Him and give Him praise. I'm gonna dance and praise Him. It doesn't matter what comes my way. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. A man of His kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. More than a conqueror. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. More than a conqueror. Come against me, shall ever prosper. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. I'm head of His kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. More than a conqueror. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. More than a conqueror. 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 More than victorious. More than you will win. You are more than victorious in this season. More than victorious. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in Him. I rejoice in him. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Just worship you wherever you are. Just lift your name of Jesus high. You are more than a victorious. You are more than a winner. Just lift your voice. Just worship him. Rejoice in the Lord. In the midst, Bible said, rejoice always. Rejoice. 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 Just clap wherever you are. The devil is defeated. Just put the enemy to shame. We are not going to dance to the tune of coronavirus or the diseases or the tune or the bad news around. Just rejoice in the Lord. Just clap your hands and just worship him. You are more than a conqueror. Just rejoice in him. That is the word of God. Just celebrate Jesus. Celebrate him. Celebrate him. He is a faithful God. Just rejoice in him. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy of our praise. Just lift your voice and just praise him. Our God is greater. He is stronger than any situation, than any problem. Just worship him. Yes. Wherever you are.
It is you we come to pray tonight. It is you we come to worship tonight.
Just worship him. Yeah, well, that is what we have come to do this morning. Just wherever you are, join me and just worship him. What are you turning to wine? Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like me. Not like you. Into the darkness we shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Not like you. What are you turning to wine? Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. Not like you. Into the darkness we shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Not like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God. Our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God. Turn into wine. Open the eye to your mind. There's no one like you. Not like you. Into the darkness we shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Not like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our
God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God. Our God is for us, who will never stop us. And if our God is with us, what can we stand against? If God is for you, coronavirus will never stop you. Nothing will ever stop you. If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? Who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? What can stand again? What can stand against us? If the Lord is with us, economic crisis, financial downturn, diseases, every plague, every epidemic, nothing can stand against us. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God. Just worship him. There is nothing that will ever stop us. Nothing in this world can ever stop us. That is what we are singing. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Our God is higher than every situation. God is higher than every problem. God is higher than every disease. That is what we have come to say, Lord, we thank you. We give you praise for accepting our praises and our worship this morning. Wherever you are, I want you to join me and sing this song with me. I just lift the name of the Lord high. You are good and your mercies forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercies forever. Hallelujah. Oh, you are good and your mercies forever. Hallelujah. Oh, you are good and your mercies forever. Hallelujah. The Lord is good. His mercies is still endured forever. He never changes. He's still the same God. He's still a loving Father. Coronavirus, diseases, epidemics, plague, informations, bad news, death does not change who he is. And I thank God for your life, and I thank God that the Lord has preserved you to this day. I thank God for his mercy, his love, his kindness that never changes. Lord, we appreciate you for accepting our praise and our worship. Lord, we give you all the praise. We give you all the worship. For in Jesus' name we have worship. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are going to go into the word of the Lord this morning. All throughout the last 2 weeks, we've been discussing about how do you respond in a situation that you find yourself in, a situation, the world, the global world, in an uncertainty. How do you respond? We've noticed that when you're listening to news, listening to informations, listening to people, you feel that what is the order of the day is fear. But the Bible says that the Lord has not given us the spirit of fear, but he has given you respond when life is not going the way you expected it, the way you want it to go into? How do you respond to it? And the first thing we talked about is that we said, one, you have to recognize and reactivate the covenant the Lord had with you. And what was the covenant? The Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 17 that David was able to face Goliath because he remembered that he is a covenanted child. Because he looked at Goliath and said, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine?" And the Bible says that the Lord said that anyone that who trusts and obey me, the Lord says, your enemy shall be my enemy. Your affliction shall be my affliction. That means the Lord is going to stand to fight for you. You know how it ended. And we talked about last week about that one. The world is seeking for clarity, and the clarity is showing much about insecurity. Thereafter, then you hear a lot of news, you hear a lot of things coming up. It seems that we don't have clarity about even the coronavirus, about the epidemics. Today, you hear a different story. Next time, you hear a different kind of conspiracies going around. But the main truth is that we say that you have to trust God. And today, we are going to look into more on how to react to circumstances that are beyond your control. We've known very, very clearly that absolutely that this coronavirus we are going through is unprecedented. It has never happened before. It has turned a lot of lives upside down. Many things that people depend on are no longer available now. Events, most events have been canceled. If you love sports like me, Wimbledon have been canceled, and tennis, sports, football, a lot of events have been canceled. Businesses and schools shut down, churches are closed for unforeseeable future. Nobody knows what is going on. We've been told that the best way to shut this pandemic is for us to stay at home. And as this crisis goes longer and longer, people are feeling the economic stress on their finances. Many people are now pulled out of work with no income and no idea when they are going to go back. But then the question we are asking ourselves and what we want to ponder this morning is, how should you react to circumstances that is beyond control? What should you do when things you depend on are taken away from you? What do you do when life stops working the way you expected it to work? That is what we are going to look at this morning. These are legitimate questions everyone is asking these days. When life doesn't work, it looks it is worthless. It is worthless. I want to help you to discover this morning everything that life, just a practical step, a practical faith that can give you hope and purpose and meaning and happiness in the middle of this crisis. A faith that works when it doesn't. But I love what David said in Psalm chapter 23. David says something. He says, even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, like news after news, you hear the figures, you have the tally about the number of deaths that we hear thereafter today. But the Bible said, David said to himself, even if I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why will he not fear no evil? He says that the Lord is with me. The Lord is with me. And I believe that as you tune in this morning, the Lord is with you. I'm going to give you, I discover seven truths that occur or happen during this period of this pandemic. How life developed through this pandemic. And look at I will give you seven typical ways that people react to crisis. And I notice it happens in this play. There are seven ways people have reacted when this epidemic started, when coronavirus started. There are seven ways that people, it shows me clearly that there are seven ways people react to crisis. Number one is denial. I remember when it started in Wuhan in China, some people even here said, this is not my problem. That is the first thing, is denial. Sometimes people say it is not our problem. Coronavirus is in another country. it may not even be real. Some people denied it, that it may not be real. That was the first step. That some people look at it, it's an epidemic or plague. Some people look at it, it's far off. They deny it, it's far off. The second step that I noticed that people react to this plague was dismissal. First is denial. Some people say, no, it is not real. It might be all these stories that is coming. The second part was dismissal. Now, some people now begin to hear news in the news. Some people begin to hear some people are dying. And they say, this may be real. It is real. But they said, no, it is not a big deal. It is going to end fast and it won't last. That was the first, second reaction of some people. Some people says denial it, but then as the news started growing up, they begin to say, it's happening in Italy now. Some people have died. Some people begin to say, no, it's not a big deal. They dismiss it secondly. And that is the way some people react to crisis. And the third way people react to crisis is defiance. Defiance is that some people, when the news started going on, and as the news is going on, they now, some people begin to say, I know they told us these things. You hear the news, these things. Then some people say, I refuse to resist my freedom. This will not resist my freedom. They were just being a kind of stubborn to it. They reacted stubbornly. And some people were saying, I'm not going to allow this to cramp my style. I still have to do whatever thing I need to do. Some people look at themselves and say, I am healthy. I'm not going to stay at home, because that was what the news started. Some people were defiant when the news, we begin to hear, one news, one case in England, in Scotland, in some places. Some people now begin to say, no. They now begin to tell us that you need to stay at home. Some people say, no. This is not going to stop my style. This is not going to stop me from whatever thing. They look at themselves. They felt they were healthy. These were the second, third kind of people that we say they reacted in a kind of defiance way. But at times goes on, I noticed the next one was delayed acceptance. Delayed acceptance. There are people who now begin to find out that as people around them, they begin to hear news of people who are dying. And when the figure is being now increased, as the figure is now being increased, thereafter day, they begin to see this is real. They now begin to say, this is a big deal. This is now a big deal. And when they now begin to say this is a big deal, they now begin to realize that this may affect me. Because now the news everywhere, information is being carried away. I said that the first one that some people have reacted was denial. That is just recalling back. Denial, it is a problem. It happens in another country. It won't happen near us. Then as things begin to come, the next thing is dismissal. Then the third one is defiance. The fourth one is delayed acceptance. So some people now begin to say, it is a big deal. It's going to affect me. Then the next one is disruption. The fifth one, disruption. What do we mean by disruption? Disruption is that now everybody is now in this phase that we are talking about. It has everything about our activity in life is now being disrupted. It's now being disrupted. So now you begin to hear people, my life is turned upside down. How can I be at home? How can I stay at home? How can I stay at home? And you found that now you found that you are faced to make some decisions, some difficult choices. Now you have to make some difficult choices because now you now found the children are out of school. You are out of work. You have financial choices to make. You have relational choices to make. You have priority choices to make. You now found that your whole life is disrupted just by these epidemics. And this is how we now begin to find that some people have found themselves in this particular phase where we talk about disruption. The disruption where it is to them that everything is disrupted. Because now, in the midst of this disruption, they now begin to think, what choices, what decision do I have to make? And the choices you have to make, you have the children, you have to do school, homeschooling for the children. Then what do? You still have to work. the people that some of us that works from home, you think about how do I relate? What do I do? How do I relate even with my friends? How do I? You begin to find that now is a time for you to make choices. Because everything that you've depended on, everything that you've known, every activities, everything is now disrupted. We are most of people are in this particular position, in this place where we are talking about disruption. And the next one is distress. Next one is distress. What do we mean by distress? That when is done on that, that is going to last for a long time, because nobody expected that this is going to last for a long time. Unfortunately, this has put too many of us into some distress, and you now found everything has changed. Everything, distress, everything has changed. You now begin to notice that this pandemic is not going away. It's not over within a week. Nobody is even sure. It's not even, we've been for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. We're not even not sure how. You now begin to find some people now, their life is just in a distress. I've heard of a story of a man who even killed himself. Why? Well, just because this was the way he felt, that this is the way to do what? Respond to this crisis. How do you to respond? Because he felt that he killed himself, killed his wife. Because he felt that everything in life is all gone. Everything in life, how can he bounce back? How can he come back? Distress. And some people are even, excuse me, some people are even in this situation that we never had this kind of turn, because we've never had this kind of pandemic over time. It has changed everything. It has changed a lot of things, and it has caused a lot of distress, because some people are in the position, how do I come out of it? Some people are just like their life, that they are locked up. They felt that they are locked up in their home. You found there is no happiness. There is no joy. There is no peace in their life. And that was the thing. That was the way they felt. That is the way they have to respond to this. But we are going to look into how am I, when all things are taken away, when things are out of control, how do I respond to it? How do I respond to it? The seventh one is the one I love so much. There are a lot of things now happening recently. You found on Thursday, people clap hands for the NHS, the key workers. What was the thing? Is the seventh one. Some people are responding by determination. What do you mean by determination? You hear a lot of people now say, we will get through it. Some people say, by the grace of God, we are going to get over this together. Even as the Queen is going to speak to us tonight, you hear that it is going to be a message of hope to tell us that we are trying, we are pushing hard. And everybody is now coming up to the point and says, this pandemic, this epidemic, this trouble, we shall get over it. Everybody is now fighting together. There is no more denial. There is no more dismissal. There is no more defiance. There is no more delayed acceptance. There are a lot of people in this seventh stage. In this seventh stage. And this seventh stage is a seventh stage of determination. They are now saying that we must make these two pass. That we know, yeah, we know it is hard. We know it is difficult. But we believe that. We believe that we will come out of it. We believe that we will come out of it. And that is a determination that you now see a lot of people are now having, that started to have. And that is the way people are responding. And how are they responding? They are helping each other. They are trying to go knock on doors and doors, showing love, showing kindness. Because now there is determination, because everybody is equally saying that we will pass through this. We will get over this. We will get over this. In as much that the tally, the news, the figures of the dead people or the victims are increasing every day. But now there is that hope. There is that hope in the life of a lot of people that are responding now and says, I don't need to be unhappy. I don't need to be in distress. I don't need, because I'm locked down. I know that a lot of things have been taken away from me. I know that, yes, I have kids to take care of. I know I don't think about tomorrow. I don't think about every other thing. But now, there is a determination that let me forget about tomorrow. I believe that we will overcome coronavirus. I believe that this pandemic, this epidemic must come to pass. Determination. But today we are going to talk about choices. That is what we are going to look into. Because we're talking about like a series, just like what I mentioned, that you have decisions. When you come in distress, you have some decisions to make. Every day you have to analyze. Day after day, you have to analyze and draw conclusions. Every day that comes, days now is like a mystery. Every day that comes, you listen to news, you draw conclusion, you analyze, you have choices to make. You draw conclusion. We make our choices, and our choices make us. We all make choices, and that our choices is what makes us. How does God, then we are looking at, that it is trusting in God that will help you to do what? It will help you to make the right choices. It makes choices easier. If you trust in God, that was why we mentioned something to say that the other time we said that one of the ways is to trust in God. Somebody will ask me a question, how does trusting in God make my choices easier? We are going to look at the Bible, James chapter 1. Verse 5 to 8. But before I share that, before we read that in James chapter 1, that is going to be our anchor scripture today, for today. But before we look into that, before I share how trust in God will make choices in your first, let me discuss what I mean by tough choices. Because right now, everybody is making tough choices. What do I mean by tough choices? I know it necessarily, and the tough choices I'm talking about, I believe that tough choice is not necessarily a significant choice. You know, when the one I'm talking about is not you making a tough choices on what to wear or what to eat. That is not the choices I'm talking about. The tough choices that we are in, that we are talking about, is a tough choice when none of the option is more favorable. That is when you have to decide two good things. When you have to decide two good things is presented to you. Two good things, but the thing is that they are equally good. Or when you decide to have two bad things, they are equally bad. Or two painful things that are equally bad. But then you don't know which choice to make. That is what I mean by tough choices. Tough choices. That is why we have to look at God's word today. In those kind of situations where you cannot find one advantage over the other, since you can't decide, because I know some people, when they find themselves in a tough situation, since they can't decide, what they will do is to toss a coin. But I don't want us to understand. I want us to understand that when you toss a coin, you're limiting your life to the life of chance. But God has not given us, you're limiting your power. But God has not given us our life to be a game of chance. God has not given us. The ability to make decisions is one of the greatest gifts to you. The ability to make decisions is one of the greatest gifts that God has given to you. It is what makes woman. It is what makes woman. Animals can't decide on anything, but you don't want to give it to chances. So today we are looking at, you want to know how to make tough choices in a time of this crisis. How do I make choices? What do I have to do? How do I make? I want to know, think of something. Okay, now let me throw it to you. Think of something specific for this week, or you may face this week. Maybe I'm going to pay my rent or my mortgages, but I'm out of work. These are tough choices. You have to, a choice with kids, like this week, you still have the kids with you. You have the kids with you. How do I do this? You know, it is very difficult. The choices that you make, you are having a tough time to decide what to do. That is a problem we are all in, because as we're in the house, we are thinking of, what is the best way? What is the thing that I need to do? Then let me show you, how will trusting God make that decision easy? How will trusting God make it easy for you? So we are going to look at the scripture, what the Bible says. Then first one is when I trust God, he gives me his wisdom. That is the first one. When I trust God, he gives me his wisdom. And that is what I mean when I'm faced with tough choices. Like now that we are in a tough choices, we don't know left or right what to do, where to do, how to take care of the kids, what future holds. In a tough crisis like this time, what I need is when I trust God, he gives me where there is no clear advantage on one another. Look at, okay, let's read the Bible so that it makes it easy. James chapter 1, verse 5. That is when I trust God, he gives me his wisdom. James chapter 1, verse 5. Let's also look at it. He says, if any of you lack wisdom, you should pray and ask God, because he gives it generously to anyone who asks. He never resents you asking. So that means God loves to help you, and he will give you the wisdom you need. That is it. Another way, that is what we're saying, is that just all you need to do is just to ask. It's just to ask. Just ask. Ask. He said, why you have not received is just because you have not asked. You haven't got it because you haven't asked. Why should I want wisdom? Okay, that is the question somebody will be asking me. Why should I want wisdom? Okay, let's look at, if you read the books of Proverbs, all the books of Proverbs, you will find 30 practical ways of wisdom. But let me give you one. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18. What did he say? Bible says, those who become wise will be happy. Those who become wise will be happy. And then he now says, wisdom is the key to a blessed life. Look at the Bible. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18. He said, those who become wise will be happy. Wisdom is the key to a blessed life. So do you want to be happy in a tough time like this? He says, wisdom is the key. Is the key. It's a wisdom. And that is why when you trust God, he gives you the wisdom. And that is why we read in James chapter 1, where he's 5, he now said, do any of you lack wisdom? Let him ask of the Lord. And then the Bible now says, mention it here to say that if anyone wants to be happy in a time like this, when you see everybody, people are not happy, people are locked down, people are in isolation, people don't even know what to do. There is everybody, when you look at face of people, you feel that death, mourning, it is sadness that roams the day. But the Bible says, does anyone want to be happy? He says that what? He says that you get wisdom. That was what he said, wisdom. And he said the key to a blessed life is wisdom. And who gives the wisdom? Is God himself. Is the one that gives the wisdom. He's the one that gives the wisdom. Then that means you want to be happy and you want to be blessed. We need God's wisdom. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. Look at what he says. He said, getting wisdom is the most important thing you can get in life. Getting wisdom is the most important thing you can get in life. So that means it is not about the social event. It is not about the work. It is not about the finances. But by the other way, you can say that when you get wisdom, you get all these things. He says, wisdom, getting wisdom, that is Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. He said, getting wisdom is the most important thing you can get in life. It's more important than fame. It is more important than pleasure. It's more important than success. Because when you get wisdom, all these things follows you. In the days ahead, while you are out of work or now you are at home, you can use these days now to get wisdom. So that when you go back to work, eventually, whenever we go to work, back to work, you can become wiser. You can become blessed. You can become more happier. You can become more smarter. That is what we are talking about this morning. So that get wisdom. Use this day. Get wisdom. Acquire wisdom. Just like the Bible said that wisdom is the most important thing. So these days that you are indoor, these days, trust in the Lord. And the Lord, ask him for wisdom. And when you ask him for wisdom, when you go back to work, you become more wiser. You become more blessed. You become more smarter and happier. That was what we read in the Bible. The Bible said we need wisdom in our life. But because, all right, you know, human being, we are imperfect. Let's just be honest with ourselves. We are imperfect. And the possibilities of errors in our choices is very high. The possibility of errors in our choices is very, very high. How many times do you make wrong decisions? Let's just be honest. Or how many times do you make wrong decisions, but you give up too soon? Or sometimes it can be you waited for too long, or you said the wrong thing. There have been so much hurt and pain in our life. It's all come from foolish decisions and bad choices. Some of the foolish decisions we make and bad choices, some pain and some hurt in our life. So if you get wisdom, Bible says that is why you need wisdom. In this tough time, in this crisis, all you can ask for is wisdom. And the Bible says that why you have not received is because you've not asked. Let's look at Proverbs 24:25. I love that word. It says, wisdom is good for the soul. If you get wisdom, you will have a bright and secure future. Look at the Bible. It's very, very, I love the scripture. It says, Proverbs 24:24, it says, wisdom is good for the soul. If you get wisdom, you will have a bright and secure future. You will have a bright. Do you want your future to be bright? Do you want to have a secure future? The Bible says, get wisdom. Get wisdom. And you've already known how to get the wisdom. God said that if you trust me and ask me for wisdom, I will give you. You cannot match the wisdom of God, which you know. The world today have tried all they could, tried to figure out. You found information we received today from the start to today. Some of the information we are asking for clarity. Today we hear some symptoms of coronavirus. Tomorrow you hear a different thing, and we have some conspiracies about this thing. But do you want to receive a good and future for your future to be bright? Even in the midst of this, do you want your life to be secured? You need that wisdom. And I know that some of you may be asking a question and says, yeah, he has been talking about wisdom. He has been speaking about wisdom. He has been echoing about wisdom all this while. How do I get the wisdom I need? That is what you may be asking me now. You understand me? Yeah, how do I get the wisdom I need in this crisis? How do I get the wisdom? How do I get the wisdom that I need? That is a question everyone may be asking me. But the Bible gives us three ways. There are three ways I will give you, and possibly we will continue on this series next Sunday. How do I get this wisdom that we are talking about? Remember, we're just only on one. The first one, that is what we are. When I trust God, he gives me wisdom. It is what we are talking about, the wisdom. In a time like this, you need wisdom. But the question you're asking now could be, how do I get the wisdom I need? I will give you three ways that you can get this wisdom. Number one, put God first in your life. If I put God first in my life, make him the top priority in my thoughts and in my life. In my thoughts and in my life. In my money, in my relationship, if I put God first, that is, if you want to get wisdom, if you want to get wisdom that you need at this time In the moment of this crisis, you need God's wisdom. And how do you get this wisdom? Put God first in everything, in your life. Let's read the Bible. Maybe you will be asking. Psalm chapter 111, verse 10. Psalm 111, that is 111, verse 10. Look at what the Bible says. Bible says, reverence for the Lord is the foundation of all true wisdom. Reverence, respect, honor of the Lord is the foundation, of all true wisdom. That means the rewards of wisdom are given to anyone who listens and obeys God. If you listen to God and obey Him, that is where your true wisdom comes. God doesn't give wisdom to everyone. He doesn't give wisdom. And I'm being honest with you. He doesn't give wisdom to everyone. He gives wisdom to one. Number one, we've read it in the Bible. For those who ask and those who trust in Him. For those who ask and for those who trust in Him. If you read Proverbs chapter 15, verse 33, he says, honoring God and being humble leads to wisdom. Honoring God. Honoring God. That is the scripture. I love it. Honoring God, it leads to wisdom, and wisdom will bring honor to you. When you honor God, when you honor God and you are humble, it says it will bring honor to you. When you honor God, He gives you wisdom. When you are humble, He gives you wisdom. Be humble or you stumble. Be humble. Like now, we found that this pandemic has humbled everyone. Some people have stumbled. They be humble by trusting God, obeying God, so that you will not stumble. Be humble. Be humble. Instead of depending on your own wisdom, be humble and wisdom comes. And wisdom comes. And wisdom comes. The second is practice God's word in my life. It is not only by reading God's word. It is not only by putting God first in your life. No, you can say now I put God first in my life. It is not just put God first, but practice His words in your life. Practice the word of God. And what was the word of God? The Bible is filled. The Bible is filled with wisdom. The Bible is filled with wisdom. It's filled with wisdom. It's filled with wisdom. Practice God's word. Practice God's word. It fills with wisdom. You get wisdom by applying it, implementing and doing what God says. Look at John chapter 13, verse 17. John 13, verse 17. John 13, 17, it says, now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Now that you hear this, now that you've known this, you will be blessed if you do them. You will be blessed if you do them. The only true Bible we believe is the part we practice. You know, I hear a lot of people who come to say, yeah, I believe God's word. I believe God's word. No. Believing is practicing what you believe. If you don't practice what you don't, you practice what you read. If you don't practice it, you don't believe in it. It's just a simple thing. So that means the belief that we are talking about is you practicing God's word. So if you practice God's word, it shows that you believe it. You believe that it will work. 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 31. It says, in that place, God's way is always perfect. And God's word is always true. So you know that there have been a lot of lies, a lot of conspiracy that have gone ahead because of this pandemic. But look at Bible. There is only one place. There is only one place. He said God's word is perfect. His word is perfect. And His word is ever true. There are no lies in this word. In this word. So that means, do I need something to deliver me in this situation? I will always go for the word, for the truth. I'm rushing because of our time. We will continue for the second part of it. It says, that means when I have a difficult decision to make, like what we've read, When I have a difficult decision to make, I go to God's word. Because why? Why do I have to go to God's word? I don't have to be engrossed by the news. Because one thing is, God's word is perfect and God's word is true. God's word is perfect. So that means in the midst of all these tough things that are going around, going everywhere, the thing is that what is God's word saying? What is God's word? What is God's word? What if you want to overcome this situation? That means you have to practice what God's word said. And James chapter 1, verse 25 says, if you look intently into God's perfect word that gives you freedom, and you continue to do this, not forgetting what you have learned, and then you put it into practice in your life, you will be blessed in everything you do. Ah, I love God's word. James chapter 1, verse 25. He said, if you look intently into God's perfect word that gives you freedom, and you continue to do this, not forgetting what you have learned. The Bible says, and then you put it in practice in your life. That is God's word. He said, you'll be blessed in everything you do. Do you want to be blessed in the midst of crisis? Do you want to be blessed in this pandemic? Do you want to be blessed when people look at you? People are saying they are casting down. And the Bible says, you yourself, you're saying there is a lifting up. In the opposite, you are speaking differently. Why? Was because God's word said it. That is what God's word said. You will be blessed in everything you do when you practice God's word. Then the third one, quickly, before we round up and pray, it says, the third one, that how do I need wisdom? Remember, I said the first one is put God first in your life, practice God's word in your life, and thirdly, get some godly people into your life. Get some godly people into your life. The people you hang out with in the most of your life, they are either helping you or hurting you. It's either now, you know, the people you call over the phone, the people you talk to in a time of this crisis, it's either they are doing one thing, it's either they are building your fear or they are building your faith. Because there are some people you hear, when you call them over the phone, they are ever telling you, it's all bad news, it's all bad news, it's all bad news. They are building fears in you. So find godly people who will speak faith into you. Even some people, yes, it is of a truth, the news or whatever thing they are saying. Yes, it's a fact. But the thing is that we're not dismissing the fact. We are not dismissing the fact. We're not dismissing the figure. But the thing is that you need to build your faith, not to live in fear. When God was speaking to his children, he says, is that like, I have not given you the spirit of fear. As fear looms around, look for godly people, not the one that will build your fear, the one that will build your faith. Look out for those ones, not the ones that are making you more cowardly. Look for ones that will make you more courageous. The one that will let you know that you will overcome. The one that will let you know that you will get through it. Not the one that is either causing you to worry, but let it be the one that will cause you to worship. Not the one that causes you to worry, but the one that will cause you to worship. Just worship him. The one that will cause you, not the one that will become stress generators. Just panic everywhere. The one that will cause stress. But look for the people who are stress relievers. And I want to conclude by telling you, the quality of your life and the quality of your decisions and the quality of your choices will determine who you spend most of your life with. The quality of your life, the quality of your decision in a time like this, the quality of your choices in a time like this will depend mostly on the people you spend your life with. If you spend your life with Netflix, spend your life with movies, Sky, everything, you found that your life, if these things are taken away, Believe me, that is where we are in a position now, that when these things are taken away, some people are feeling so distressed and so down. But if you spend your life with the word of God, you spend your life with the people that will build you up, you will find that actually says, look at what the Bible says. Let me read the Bible and then I conclude. It says, Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. If you keep company with the wise, you will become wise. Proverbs 13, verse 20. If you keep company with the wise people, you say you become wise. But if you hang out with foolish people, you will suffer from making bad decisions. That's the Bible. It's not me that wrote it. This is the Bible. Proverbs 13, verse 20. If you keep company with wise people, you will become wise. But if you hang out with foolish people, you will suffer from bad choices. And I pray that as you hear this God's word today, you will make right choices in a time like this. And what we have asked God is, God, give me wisdom. Wisdom. And wisdom comes by you trusting God. That is where it comes from. And maybe you are listening to my voice this morning, and you want to accept the Lord Jesus into your life because he is the author of wisdom. He's the one that says, why you have not received this wisdom is because you have not asked. So this morning, wherever you are, I want you to pray with me that you know the first way. You say, this wisdom is not given to everyone. It is given. It is given to those who ask and trust God. And I want to pray with you. Wherever you are, you and give your life to Jesus and give your life to the author of wisdom. I want you to pray with me. I say, Lord Jesus, I come to you. Have your way in my life. I have known that you are the only one who can save me, who can deliver me from fear. And I believe your word. Lord Jesus, have your way into my life. I believe you died on the cross for me. And from this day onwards, I become yours. I believe in you. For in Jesus' name. Amen. And I believe that as you've made that prayer and you follow to study God's word, read God's word, believe me, there will be that change in you. And for others, wherever you are, I want you to just lift your voice wherever you are or quietly, just pray for God's wisdom. Ask God, God, give me wisdom. Give me wisdom in this tough time to make the right decision, that I've known that the only way I can be blessed and my future can be secured is only key, only by your wisdom. And Lord, you said, if I ask, you will give me this wisdom. Lord, you said, if I ask, oh God, Father, I'm coming to you because I believe you are the author of wisdom. Lord, I pray in a time like this, when the world is confused, Lord, I pray to make the right decision. Lord, I pray that you give me wisdom. Give me wisdom. Give me wisdom. Father, I pray for everyone under the voice of under the auction of my voice. I pray that you release wisdom unto them. Let wisdom be released unto you. May you make right decision. May you make right decision. And may the Lord keep you. May the Lord protect you. And I pray over your life that in a time like this, may the Lord continue to shield you. I empty fear over your life. And I pray that the Lord will continue to uphold you. The Lord will shield you and your family. Just according to God's word says that he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And you shall say of the Lord, he is my refuge. He is my fortress. And I pray that the Lord protect you. The Lord cover you. And may the hands of the Lord be with you. Thank you. And God bless you for joining us today. And I believe that in the next on Wednesday, we are going to go into prayer, praying for the nation, praying for all the key workers, praying for families, praying for the leaders of our nation, just asking God for guidance and leading. Please join us again on Wednesday 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. And the Lord will continue to be with you. And may the wisdom of the Lord go with you. May God bless you. Thank you for joining. And the Lord light shine upon you. God bless you. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Unto Pastor CG Tabernacle of Grace service this morning. Thank God that today is a time.